Let's welcome in Congresswoman Candace Miller out of Macomb County on the other end of our line this morning with a lot going on all around us. How are you, Congresswoman Miller?
Hey, good, Frank. Good morning.
Good morning. Your phone been ringing off the hook since Mike Rogers said he wasn't running for the U.S. Senate. People trying to get you to change your mind on that?
I had a lot of pressure very early on. The polling showed me sort of ahead of the field there, but I'm enjoying what I'm doing in the House. I think I can make an impact here, and I think obviously Mike Rogers came to the same conclusion. And you know, we have a pretty deep bench here in the Republican field, and I'm very enthusiastic about Terry Lynn Land's announcement that she's going to be a candidate. So it's going to be an interesting race, that's for sure. Plenty of issues, all kinds of challenges on the national level, and people of Michigan are going to have a front row seat of determining who has a majority in the United States Senate.
Well, I know you love those ex-secretaries of state. That's very close to your heart. But will you consider urging Dave Camp to run?
Dave Camp would be a fantastic candidate as well. You know, he's got his hands full here in the House, chairman of the Ways and Means, and this is a guy that has just been marinating in the issues that they're looking at with comprehensive tax reform, which would be a historic pivot for the nation. So, you know, this is his last term as chairman because on the Republican side we have term limits for our chairman. And if he is able to accomplish something like that, I mean, that's what his entire focus is right now. I don't know what he does after that. We'll see. But, you know, it's still early in this time. Everybody says, oh, you got to get out so early. But I think in the fall we'll have a much clearer picture of what is what. But again, I mean, I'm very enthusiastic about Terry Lynn Land.
You're comfortable she can beat Gary Peters?
Yes.
All right. So much going on in Washington, and you know, there have been so many scandals of late involving Benghazi and the IRS and wiretaps by the NSA. Then we get news the IRS is paying $70 million in employee bonuses according to its union agreement. I didn't know IRS employees got bonuses. I'm not sure for what. The Senate bill on immigration will allow 46 million immigrants by 2033, according to the CBO, and is going to reduce Americans' average wages if that's enacted. And this is overshadowing a lot of what is going on internationally, with the president now in Germany about to make a suggestion that we reduce our nuclear arsenal once again. I know you've been concerned about that and our position with regards to Syria, where we're in a sort of a stare down with Vladimir Putin and the Russians right now.
Well, you're absolutely right. You sort of laid it out. We have all of these challenges, and they're big. They're enormous. We've got these scandals. We have to make sure we follow the truth where it takes us. However, Frank, we cannot lose sight of something like this in regards to Syria, because I'll tell you right now, this is a time for questions to be raised by anyone who has consternation, which I do. And I'd say one thing, if we've learned anything in the last 10 years in Iraq and Afghanistan, it is that American involvement in a Muslim sectarian civil war comes at an enormous price, and generally there is no good outcome. I mean, we don't have any idea who these rebels are. We don't know what their feelings are about the people around them, what sort of policies, if they got in command there, what would they implement? Would they be supportive of terrorism? We have no idea what they would do with the WMDs that Assad has right now. I just see this thing, Frank, as it's like Libya Part 2, and I do not see the clear United States interest. Time to speak out.
Well, in the meantime, you also have the, as I said, the government of Russia, led by Vladimir Putin, helping to further arm President Assad, who's in power there and being opposed by these rebels who have voiced support for al-Qaeda, for heaven's sake. And this is a major face-to-face with the Russians on this. What do we do now? Because we sort of have set the policy and said, number one, we're on the side of the rebels. Number two, if they cross this imaginary red line and use any chemical weapons, or there's a hint of that, we're sending troops in, we're really going to get serious. Well, they have, and they've continued to do whatever they want under this Assad regime, and we've sort of sat by. What kind of credibility are we gaining throughout the Middle East and the rest of the world over this?
Well, I think we all need to engage in this debate. It's a national debate. And, I mean, I'm listening to a lot of hawks. I think of myself as a strong defense hawk. But, look, they're saying, well, we did the no-fly zone in Libya. Well, you know, Frank, I was against that. I was on your show talking about it. And I'll tell you one thing. Having a no-fly zone in Libya where you only have two cities, Tripoli and Benghazi, then the rest is a desert, is a heck of a lot easier than in Syria, where you have anti-aircraft guns provided by Russia, as you're talking about Russia, probably manned, perhaps, certainly by Russian contractors, maybe even elements of the Russian military, who knows. And with all the problems that we have in the world right now, we are thinking about a possible proxy war with Russia? Seriously? Seriously. Let us think about this for a moment. I mean, I'll say one thing. I mean, I've always been a huge admirer of Colin Powell. He used to say that you have to be very decisive. I mean, if you're going to do something like this, if you're going to go in, you need to be decisive. You have to lay out a very clear, concise, comprehensive message. You have to define the goal so the American people know what the goal is, and certainly the troops know what the goal is, what we're trying to accomplish. And then, by the way, you have to have a clear exit strategy. And, Frank, I haven't heard that. I don't think the nation has heard that yet from President Obama. He is the commander-in-chief. He needs to make this case, and his generals need to help us understand how we're going to accomplish that, because right now the generals in the Pentagon are saying, you just can't go in and establish a no-fly zone overnight. They are very hesitant about what he and Secretary of State Kerry are saying. I just have huge concerns about this. I mean, you've got some, they see this as a civil war between, you know, poorly armed rebels who are struggling to free themselves from this evil dictator, the grip that he has on that. And then, you know, many who see this as a religious war between Hezbollah and Al-Qaeda. Now, I just am asking the question, why is the United States risking taking sides in a battle, civil war, sectarian war, between two terror organizations? Who is our ally? Which one is our ally?
Carry that into Afghanistan now, too, where we just announced this week that we're going to hold talks in Qatar with the Taliban. And now Hamid Karzai, the president of Afghanistan, says, wait, I thought you were on our side. They're still bombing us. And if you're doing that, then we're not a part of these talks. So we're going to have talks with the terrorist organization, the Taliban, which supports Al-Qaeda, and the government that we put in place in Afghanistan is saying, we're left out. We're not going to be a part of it. And this is falling apart in front of our eyes.
Well, this is why the president has to come out and he has to make his case, because I tell you, right now you have a lot of loud voices. I'll give you an example. One on my side of the aisle, Senator John McCain, who I have huge respect for his history and what he did as a POW, etc. But I'll tell you what, he's been one of the loudest voices arming the rebels. And I'm listening to him thinking, you know what? It was him. I remember him going a couple years ago to Benghazi to meet with the rebels in Libya. He said they were freedom fighters. He said we had a humanitarian duty to support them. Well, I don't know how that, I mean, we know how that turned out, because you had these same Libyan rebels attacked our consulate, murdered the American ambassador, four other brave Americans, probably using arms that we supplied. Now, several weeks ago, I watched McCain, you know, great senator. However, this is the time to raise your voice if you have a question, because he goes to Syria, he meets with the Sunni rebels fighting Assad regimes, the regime there, and they're freedom fighters. He says we have a humanitarian duty to support them. Then he takes a picture. There were pictures all over with him standing there with several suspected terrorists. I would just say, look, if you can't even get the photo right, how are we going to get it right by arming these people?
Was the Weather Underground a freedom fighting organization or a group of domestic terrorists? You know, I mean, you can. This is it almost borders on the absurd when you break it down.
Well, as I say, with all the challenges going on, I appreciate the American people are just my gosh, you're like in a pinball machine here with all these different things coming at you. But we have to look at what is really the most important thing that's happening here. And I'll tell you right now, when you have the president and the secretary of state talking about going into Syria, we do have to focus on that, I think. And I think as Americans, if we disagree with this, this is the time to raise your voice and certainly in the Congress. I'm not alone on this. I'm raising these concerns. And again, I am very strong defense, very strong military, but I need to know, what are we under threat of attack? I mean, why are we doing this? What is our United States' vital interest if we are going to go in and arm terrorists? If we're going to do that, I need the commander-in-chief to tell me why we need to support that, and I have not heard that yet.
Yeah, I've gone too long here, but I got to have you give me your thoughts on what the president's reportedly going to announce today, which is that he wants to pursue a further reduction of nuclear weapons because there's very, very little chance that there would ever be a nuclear attack against us.
Well, I'll wait to hear what the president has to say on that, but I'll tell you, we have a different opinion, many on my side of the aisle, about that, and even missile defense. This is another thing the president has not been as supportive as many of us have been. And with everything that is going on in the world, the first and foremost responsibility of the federal government is to provide for the common defense. That is in the preamble of our Constitution. And when you're disarming us, again, the president will have to make his case, but I think in light of all of these other things, he's going to have a hard time making a case for that.
Appreciate the time, Congresswoman Candace Miller. Talk to you soon.
Thank you, Frank.
Take care.